Hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar today, Business Advisory Services Implementation. ESS BizTools has been presenting a series of webinars looking at the challenges that accountants have in implementing diversification type strategies. So today I'm joined by Mark Holton. G'day, Mark. How are you?
G'day, Pete. Nice to be here.
Thank you very much for being with us. Mark's a director of Smith Inc. and a very experienced accounting practitioner from the Central Coast in New South Wales. And Mark's going to be discussing with us some of the diversification strategies that he thinks accountants should be looking at in a couple of minutes' time. So thank you for joining us today, Mark, and I'll be back with you shortly.
Not a problem, Pete.
Thank you. Diversifying accounting services, why? It's an interesting question. Some accountants have asked me that. But what are your firm's points of difference? Because we need to be able to identify where you're different. Because unfortunately, a lot of the SME market thinks that accountants supply the same type of services all the time. And I know that many of you are trying to differentiate your services. You become an expert or a specialist in a particular area. Do your clients know that? Do your prospects know that? If you created some industry specializations, you might be an expert in the pharmacy industry or medical industries or tradies or farmers or others that you have got a particular following because businesses operating in those areas believe that you know something about it. There's a very large practice in regional New South Wales that are experts in merino wool, beef cattle, cotton farming, and horticulture. And they've earned that reputation over the years because they concentrated on those specific industries. Is that an opportunity for your firm? Does your firm have experts? Have you got people who have written papers, prepared social media, talked at conferences, gone with clients to industry events? I went to a real estate conference many years ago with a client because I was preparing a business plan for him. And he said, do you want to come and learn a bit more about the real estate industry? We've got a keynote speaker coming in from Adelaide and he's worth listening to. So I went and listened, and that was a very interesting event. I learned a lot about real estate that I didn't know before, but there were 40 or 50 other real estate agents there, and some of them knew me and said, what are you doing here, Towers? What's your interest? Are you going into real estate? I think that might have been one of their main concerns. I said, no, I'm doing a business plan for Jim. You know what happened after that? I got phone calls. And I got four more business plans out of that because they thought I'd become an expert. I'd at least shown some interest in their industry. Can you do something similar? The Accounting Market Pulse Report, which has been produced for the last 6 years by the Commonwealth Bank, was released in early May this year. And it indicated that on the firms that they surveyed, only 5% were not going to diversify services over the next 2 years. So in other words, 95% are saying they will be diversifying. The survey, according to the CommBank report, was conducted all over Australia and involved small firms, medium-sized firms, and large firms. No big four firms, but a good cross-section of the Australian accounting industry. And 95% of those firms that were surveyed indicated that they were going to be diversifying services. And the CommBank believes that that group that they interviewed was representative of the Australian body of accountants, and they're basically projecting that that is what could happen to the overall industry. Now, I'll be very surprised if 95% diversify, but we'll see. But what is your firm's strategy? And that's what we're going to talk about today. And the other very important result that came out of that survey conducted by the Commonwealth Bank, was that business advisory services was nominated as the highest rating area for new products. Business advisory services, which is obviously what ESS BizTools are involved in. So the key diversification strategy for implementing business advisory services is what we're going to be talking to Mark Holton today about. So I'm now going to switch back and we will put Mark on the screen. How are you today, Mark?
Yeah, very well indeed, Peter. Very well indeed. Still locked down in Sydney, but not much I can do about that one, mate.
No, well, there's premiers trying to organise all that. Mark, what's your thoughts on diversification? Should accountants be pursuing this as an objective?
Pete, I think so. I think strategically it should be part of their eyes are wide open type approach. I know that in my firm in the past, diversification sometimes fell into my lap, as in I was a general practitioner, looked after pretty well anyone. But then you do a good job for one particular industry and they talk. So all of a sudden, you might tend to pick up a few clients that are in, you know, the same industry. And then all of a sudden, you're known as the specialist in that particular industry. What I don't see that often is that there's a strategy to go out and hunt that industry. It tends to fall into their lap. You know, I know one guy years ago I was doing some work for, consulting with, that sort of specialised in pubs. And I think his only point of experience was that he went to one every week, every afternoon on the way home.
Product research.
But, you know, he started talking to the people there, the owner there, and then the owner started to talk to other people. Then the owner started to talk to a fellow that was in charge of the Hoteliers Association. Then all of a sudden he was invited to speak at one of their conferences, display at one of their events. And all of a sudden you start to accrue more and more diversification in your firm because you're creating these niche opportunities. I know of another firm that did something quite similar with the plumbing industry and with one particular plumbing wholesaler. And again, that led to opportunities to speak at their conference, go to their events, and become sort of the specialist person.
The go-to person, yeah.
And I know another guy that specialised in the airline industry and did a stack of individual returns in Sydney for airline pilots, hostesses, and then that then evolved into support workers, baggage handlers. But his practice was heavily, heavily individual return focused. But again, he sort of specialised in different areas. Pete, I think we've got to be aware of it. We've got to start to think, you know, what areas of specialisation would I like to concentrate on? It might be medical, it might be pharmaceutical, it might be, you know, rural, in, you know, whatever that form that might be. It might be particular hospitality areas. You know, it could be not-for-profits. I'm all about, you know, offering board of advice services, financial analysis and CFO services to not-for-profits, because generally there's not that many people within those organisations that have that expertise. I know another firm that sort of did the PGA training and become one of the PGA Professional Golfers of Australia approved accounting firms on their website and picked up quite a few. But it wasn't just put the stamp on the head and off you go. This fellow actually went and spoke to the local golf pro, started to look after his stuff, then he spoke to a couple of others, and all of a sudden you're creating that niche and that little piece of diversification. The other aspect I see in diversification is to being able to future-proof your firm by offering services that the client wants, not necessarily ongoing services the client needs. But let's be frank and honest, we're going to be doing that forever. Might change, might, you know, technology, government intervention, automation might change the model, but the compliance model is pretty darn resolute. I've heard a lot of people around the world talking about, oh, it's dead, it's gone, it's going to change, but I've seen no evidence that's going to happen. You know, so it's still our most profitable model. You know, if you equate an accountant to a builder, you're not going to stop building houses, are you?
No.
But how diversified is your income stream? You know, how if you were to break down your income stream in your business, how much of it is non-compliance revenue? What's your expectation in the future to develop more non-compliance revenue? I think an awful lot of firms, Pete, do a lot of business advisory work. It's just not separated from compliance. It's often billed with compliance. It's given away for too little, if not nothing, which does my head in.
Yeah.
You know, I started this journey 25 years ago in my firm, and I was determined not to give stuff away that day, let alone 20 years later, whatever the case may be.
Yeah.
But we've got to start to think, okay, this is a cost center. This is a division in my firm. And any division in an accounting firm that does something different than core business, one, has to be staffed properly. Two, has to have systems, processes, and the most important aspect of diversification, which is the right people. And it needs things like a strategy. It needs to revisit the firm's vision, mission, values. It needs to be able to look strategically at what I'm trying to achieve, let alone economically. So I'm all about building diversified models in accounting firms, but also focusing heavily on niche opportunities, Pete.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, Mark. And whilst you were talking there, I just turned up my little green book. It's got all sorts of names in it. And one firm that jumps out to me that I think have really typified diversification in the Australian accounting industry, and I don't think they'll mind me naming them because they're well known for this, is Boyce Chartered Accountants from Cooma. Now, I first struck them at the University of New England at where Financial Management Research Center first started, where Andrew Geddes was at. And they were a firm that had started, and originally they specialized in merino wool aspects. Mm. And they had a whole process, as I remember, because one of them gave us a presentation. If you wanted to be their client, you signed on to have, in effect, a board of directors, and they were, Boyce would supply the company secretary as part of the deal, and there'd be proper business processes introduced. Some years later, I had a client when I was acting as a consultant for Oz Industry for a program called Comet, Commercializing Emerging Technology, who was developing a technology for use in the cotton industry. And I had to do some research on the cotton industry, which I didn't know much about. And what did I find? But one of the experts in a submission to the Senate on the Australian cotton industry was Boyce Chartered Accountants, who by this stage had an office in Moree, I think it was, and they had developed this reputation because they diversified that office into the cotton industry. And I gather from reading some of their material on their website, which I had a look at a few weeks ago, they've also now got an office in Wagga Wagga where the emphasis is on beef cattle, I think. And there's an office in the other side of Tamworth's that is in horticulture. So I found that an interesting exercise. We talked about agriculture and rural businesses there before. There's a firm that has deliberately gone out to create these niches in four main industries. But I remember someone asking them on one occasion, Do you still attend to the local chemist or the local pie shop? And they said, yes, we still do that work, but we have these very important niche markets that we have become experts in.
That's a great story, Pete. And they're a super progressive accounting firm, Boyce.
Hmm.
I've known of them for many, many years. Admire what they do. I really do. But it's a smart thing, isn't it, to have different diversified models in different areas. That suit the local area, of course, too.
Yeah. And presumably, therefore, some of the staff that they're hiring in those areas have got some affinity to some of these industries. Mm. You know, if you hire staff in Moree, and it's the cotton, well, perhaps the people that are working, it might be your support staff, could be some of your accountants, of course, know something about the cotton industry and whatever. So it probably helps.
You know, it just makes sense, Pete. If you're going to stick your chin out and say, I look after this particular industry, you've got to have people that understand what's going on.
Hmm.
I've done a lot of work, as you know, in the golf industry over the years, including 21 years training professional golfers in finance, business management, business improvement.
Hmm.
You've got to know the industry. You've got to know the little nuances.
Yeah.
that make that industry very different from a typical retail slash sporting environment. You know, and for any of the mad golfers online, things like how do you manage vouchers? How do you manage ball comps? You know, and the traditional model where the pro is self-employed or the pro is employed by the club, that comes under a totally different award. So there's things we've got to know. You know, and I've often found with some of the training that I've done with the golf industry that some of the accounting firms, via the golfers, by the way, so it's secondhand, you know, need to understand what makes that industry unique and why it's set up the way that it is, which is why the PGA put together an approved accountants panel as well, because they could see the need to have accounting firms that specialised in their industry. And I think more industry groups need to start to think of this and provide training to the accounting industry on how to best manage, evolve, structure, whatever you might call it, within their particular, you know, patch of business. But Pete, you made a pretty important point too, and that is with a diversified model, whether it's business advisory, financial planning, HR, IT, whatever the firm's going to do, you know, I'm dead against taking accountants that are great at compliance out of their comfort zone and trying to turn them into something they don't want to be. And I've seen that happen so many times. You know, Peter's a great accountant, clients love him, he'll be a great business advisor. Well, he already is a business advisor, but Peter doesn't want to champion the business advisory thing in the firm. He doesn't mind doing a little bit of it, but he doesn't want to make that his total 100% focus. And I find that firms that don't have the right people in this particular area have to start to look elsewhere, okay? Or spend a bit more time talking to the existing staff to see if there is a diversified champion, a business advisory per se champion, you know, sitting there in the wings, chomping at the bits to have a go at this.
Yes, I agree. And sometimes that person might not be a qualified accountant.
I've seen examples, Pete, where firms have done extremely well and the qualified accountant provides the supporting mechanism.
Yes. And I look at times and look at people like employees of pastoral activities in rural areas. Stock and station agents is what I was trying to think of then. I come from a background in the meat industry and had a lot to do with stock and station agents. And a lot of them can really work a room. They can communicate. And I think they're great business getters. And at times that might be the sort of person that the accounting firm needs to be the front runner. There's nothing to say that all these services are going to be provided by qualified accountants. And the other group is bank managers. Some of them are a little bit older because the bank managers today seems to just about disappeared on my reckoning. But the bank managers of 10, 15 years ago that had a fair bit of authority and lending ability and really got to know their clients. Now, some of those people are still out there looking for work. And for a firm that's saying, yeah, we want to get in diversification, we want to do all this, but I've only got myself and my accounting partner. We've only got 10 staff. We're all busy, but we know we want to do this. We want to grow with our clients. Perhaps at times they need to make a gigantic step and really recreate an activity. And perhaps it's not to be headed by an accountant, but I agree with you, it should be headed by someone. Someone should have that responsibility. They should have a P&L account on it and they should develop the strategies.
Yeah, you know, my model is pretty simple for accounting firms. One, you need to separate advisory from anything else. You know, but then you'd give that advice to any business, wouldn't you? Not just accountants.
That's right. And then account for it separately. Like we talk about departmentalized financial accounts. Put the advisory section into a separate P&L account and see what
it should have a budget, Pete. It should have KPIs. It should have accountability. Mm. You know, but there's three things in my mind that will get this going, and that's systems, processes, and people. And if we don't get the right systems and processes in place, then one will tend to go in one big circle. But if you don't get the right people there, you'll fall over through lack of time, lack of capacity. You know, so you look at the systems in place like ESS BizTools and the wonderful resources that I know you provide, Pete, and some of the software applications out there at the moment. Geez, I was thinking of doing a presentation on I Wish I Was Benjamin Button. I wish I could grow backwards 25 years. So, and have the availability of the resources and the software and the systems that are on the market now when I kicked off in this, because all I had was Excel and another bit of software that I've become quite famous or infamous for, and that was MYOB Profit Optimizer.
Yes.
And that was never suited for the accounting industry. It was suited for banks. We just happened to use it as well. So there was very limited resources, very limited training, support. You know, look at it these days. It shouldn't be that hard compared to going back 20 years. But 20 years ago, the same issue was there. And that is we didn't have the right structure in place in our firm to be able to do this as often as we wanted, because systematically we were loose. Process-wise, they needed to be revised. But more importantly, we had the wrong people trying to do the wrong thing.
Yes. And I think the challenge then is making sure that you understand where you fit if you're offering a chief financial officer type service, a virtual service, is that the nominee, which might be a partner, but could be a manager, or could be another person by just referring to, like a retired banker or someone, needs to understand that they're then part of the leadership team. We're not some crusading knight that's going into an organization that's above the rest of the leadership team. You're part of it because the key person in that organization is the CEO or the owner or the general manager, whatever you want to call that person, who really needs an input of ideas and knowledge. I was in that position in a public company for 11 years, and I got a lot of questions. A lot of questions from my boss, the CEO, questions from some of the external directors, questions from some of the other leadership team members. The minimum, I think, I would have spent 2 hours a day answering questions or commenting on things. We were in the international meat industry. Things were going on all over the world. And it was a lot of it was coming back into my area. What did we know? And a lot of it was a requirement to do costing exercises to say whether we could switch from producing meat to go to America, to go to Russia, or, and you know, how were we going to send it to them? All these sort of questions. No one will ever convince me that it's the CEOs of public companies, the only people that ask these questions. And some days that went all day, 10 hours of it. Pete, can you get me this? Can you get me that? Can we have a look at this? Can you, I want to have a meeting in 10 minutes. Can you have all these figures for me? That was the CEO. Who do your clients ask? That's a question to everyone out there now that's watching us live or on Facebook or on this direct feed or looking at this video later on when it suits you to watch it. Who does your SME CEO client go to? Because most of them tell me they don't ring you because you don't encourage them to, or they're a bit terrified of what the fees are going to be. And I think this is one of the challenges. You need to have this conversation with your clients and then set your teams up so that that communication from your client gets treated, gets handled, because I think that's one of the key services that the SME market's looking for, because they haven't got a CFO or an accountant in most of their organizations. But I think the profession is in such a stage now, and the technology and the communications, that you can supply that service. But I really think you need to acknowledge that you are then just part of the team, the leadership team.
Agreed 100%, Pete, 100%. You know, you look at the US market, the accounting market there, the majority of business advisory work is done by business coaches. But that's changing. I've had interest just recently from quite a few US firms about how do you get this going? What do you need to do? You know, we haven't focused on this before, but we are now. You know, so if you look at the business coaching model, generally those guys are not financially trained the way accountants are, but they still do pretty darn well because they're systematic, they're process driven, they're enthusiastic, they want to be an advisor, they want to be a financial storyteller. You know, so that's, in my mind, that's the key components of getting this happening. You've got to set up a divisional approach, you have to, whether it's a divisional cost center or whether it's just a component thereof, depending on the size of the firm, obviously. You know, and you've got to have accountability, trace and track, budgets, cash flows, KPIs. But more importantly, you can sit there and you can get prepared, you're blue in the face, Pete. Eventually, you just got to try. That's just right. step off the curb, go and have a cup of coffee with a client with no objective other than just to get to know them. Work out about 5 questions you can ask them. Strategically, of course. You know, there's a whole host of preemptive tools available to get inside their head before you meet with them, if you want to go down that pathway. But just go out and have a cup of coffee, have a chat. I guarantee you that you'll walk away with at least one opportunity.
Yes, I agree. Because in ESS, we have got the SME needs analysis, which is based on a document that Andrew Geddes originally produced. And I believe if people sit down and have that hour cup of coffee and utilize that as a prompt for themselves, that might be the 5 questions, of course, they will get work out of it.
Totally.
But you've got to, and this is really an appeal to the accountants watching this, you've got to back yourself. You've got to have the confidence that you can go out and talk to your clients. Now, these people initially are your clients. When you get in the cold consulting type work that Mark does and I do all the time, you're not dealing with clients, your own clients at most stages. Yeah. So you've got to get used to doing the cold discussions, which hopefully will warm up. But people are looking for services and advice. So I think that's what you need to do.
Yeah, great.
Get started.
Agreed 100%.
Okay, so I had meant to ask at the beginning if anyone had any questions to send them through to us. No one's done that yet, but if you do have some questions, please send them through and I'll ask Mark the question. If you're watching this on Facebook, unfortunately, you can't send through your questions at this stage, so please email them through to me, or if you're watching this at a time that suits you, on Saturday morning or Sunday night or whenever, you can also send any questions you've got through to us.
Hey, Pete, Sunday night's the grand final.
Oh, no, well, not this Sunday night. Oh, yeah, and there's a certain team.
I'm out of play until South Sydney win it.
I'm a bit surprised you haven't got a green and red shirt on, mate.
I have, Peter, just in the cupboard. I'm not bringing out yet. Not yet.
Well, best luck to both teams. But as I've also, one of my brothers is also a red hot South Sydney supporter. I better say that.
Must be a great filler.
Yeah, he's in Newcastle. Okay, so we might there's nothing else you want to add to this diversification, the implementation?
I think we've pretty well covered it. You know, my final words would be, you know, get your systems, processes and people resources right.
You know, Mark, let me ask you, how can you, wearing your smithing hat, what services do you supply to an accountancy firm to help them on this journey?
Pete, I specialise in the business advisory side of things. And what I specialise in is building the systems within the firm to make this a reality.
Hmm.
Providing training, confidence, systems, processes, checklists, resources, everything you need to get going. The one thing I can't do is sit there and do it for them.
Hmm.
So it comes back very early in the piece with discussions I have with firms around what your resources and what resources are you going to put in place? Do you plan to put in place? What resources are internal and do we need to look elsewhere? I spend a lot of time working with firms along that pathway. I also do a fair bit of practice management with firms as well. But at Smith Inc., we do events for the accounting industry, and I'm hoping many of the people online today might have been to one of our events over the last 15-odd years. But next year, in February 21-22, we're doing our Young Guns event up on the Gold Coast. It was, Pete, supposed to be in October this year, but with COVID, everything's getting pushed back. And we have to make a decision to push it back too. But we're hoping, you know, touch wood, everything will be okay for 21-22 on the Gold Coast. Young Guns for the emerging leaders in the firms. It's not technical training, it's management training. It's how to deal with clients. It's how to get advisory going. It's how to do a presentation, how to speak. It's how to network. It's how to ask the right questions of clients. All that sort of stuff that we never get trained at university to do, but it becomes a really important, formative part of being an accountant that services clients. So I'd love to see anyone online up there. Any ESS Biz Tools clients and or supporters and or listeners today can access our super early bird pricing for members of Smith Inc. So it's a very low investment to be there for the 2 days, and also see the details of that event online at www.smithinc.com. And you'll notice a landing page there for Young Guns 2022 up the very top of the screen.
Okay, thanks, Mark. So I'm just going to take the screen back now and just go through and look at some matters to do with ESS. So I think most firms are going to need to utilize specialized packages to deliver diversified services. You heard Mark just emphasizing then the need for systems, processes, and people. Well, ESS Biz Tools can assist you with the systems and the processes, the people hopefully you're going to develop, although some of our material is there to help you train and develop them. We have the starter package, which is a great way to get started, especially if you're a small firm and you have not previously been involved in the delivery of business advisory services. And also we have an advanced package, which is for firms that have got their toes in the water on delivery of business advisory services and probably got a few more in the firm. But as Mark's emphasized, have developed the strategies around all this and have a team identified. So it incorporates a wide range of tools that are ready to deliver virtually a chief financial officer service. In the starter package, we've got material on tradies' charge out rates. Tradies are a great opportunity. There's thousands of them around Australia, and most of them have been ignored, I think, for proper accounting advice over the years. Professional service firms, not only accountants, but architects, lawyers, engineers, surveyors, all are charging time, and this format will assist you to calculate that. We have a wholesale or retail profit product mix and markup rates together with the profit. What should be their marketing strategy to try to get sales of particular products so that they'll earn their profitability? Debtor systems review, survival in difficult times, which is a 38 questionnaires with material which will assist you to give mentoring advice to your clients, and business health checks. So that's the product. We've got a special starter package on for supporters of Smith Inc. So it's a discounted subscription of $900, including GST. It's normally $2,100, but because of the lockdowns that a lot of people have been experiencing, we've reduced them. Now that special's on to the 4th of October. So you can contact us if you want to be interested. You could subscribe by going to our website. There it is there, www.essbiztools.com.au, and click on subscribe to Business Advisory Services Starter Package. And please enter BASSMI, BASSMI as the discount code, because our current discount rate is $999. So you're getting it $99 cheaper because of your participation today or your participation as a supporter of Smith Inc. If you're interested in the advanced package, this includes a lot of material. It includes everything that ESS BizTools has developed. So it includes the starter package. It also includes our grant finder. And if you're not involved in finding grants for clients, this is a great opportunity because it's a great introduction to delivering business advisory services. Research and development, I think there's going to be a lot more opportunities in that area for the next couple of years because some of your clients or prospects have probably been undertaking research and development activities during the lockdowns. Accelerating commercialization grant, chief financial officer service, and capital raising. Please don't forget capital raising. This is a major diversification opportunity for you. 125% increase is what's happened in crowdsource funding equity raising in the last 12 months. There's well over $100 million now being raised in that segment of the Australian capital raising area. It's fairly simple, but there is a process which we take you right through in our material. An early stage innovation company, which is there to help someone that's undertaking research and development type activities and now needs to raise money to be able to undertake their commercialization strategy. So if you're interested in that, we have a special discount for today. The normal price is $6,500. For you people watching this video and supporters and members of Smith Inc., $3,000, including GST, and this runs through to the 4th of October. If you like to subscribe, please go to the ESS BizTools website and click on to subscribe, Business Advisory Services Advanced Package. And the code there is ADSMI, ADSMI, if you want the advanced package. If you haven't been able to write these codes down quick enough and you need them, just send us an email, peter@essbiztools.com.au, and we will send you the codes back because we'd like you to register. We also have a special offer from our affiliates. Mark, do you want to say anything more about the Smith Inc. offer for the Young Guns Conference?
No, I think I've covered it earlier, Pete. I'm happy.
Okay, righto, thanks. So, everyone will get a you're receiving a discount for the Young Guns Conference. Please go on to the Smith Inc. website. We have some offers from our other affiliates. We've got six other affiliates. Communications are a very important part of letting people know that you're offering diversified services. Brad Smart, who's an experienced journalist, 30 years experience, he has a special offer for the 10 first firm. He'll help you write your first email or newsletter. Cloud9 Associates is conducting a CPD process and they will offer you a discount if you supply them a review. Blacktown Business Group is run by Jordan Lowry. He is undertaking complimentary employment contract reviews and he has a reduction on their main package, only $399. Incidentally, we're presenting a podcast in about 10 days' time and we're starting that series with our affiliates being some of the key speakers. And the first one's going to be Jordan Lowry, where we're going to look at the issues that are confronting many of your clients at present around COVID-19. Can unvaccinated people work? Can unvaccinated people be asked to get vaccinated? What are the legal implications of all this that many SMEs are very worried about? And I know some accountants are. So we'll let you know about that. Beyond Accounting Technologies, Paul Barnaby, a fellow of the Institute of Chartered Accountants, has got a review on your preparations for predictive accounting, budgets, cash flows, projected balance sheets. Normally it costs $695. He will do that for the first 20 firms at no cost. Amanda Gascoigne is an expert in small and solo practices. And that, if that's what identifies your firm, Amanda is running a session for the first 10 firms that have subscribed to ESS BizTools to get access. Our next webinar is later this week on Thursday the 30th, where Andrew Geddes will be our keynote presenter. And we're going to talk about diversification using scaling up as the diversification strategy. And that really brings together a whole range of the activities that diversification encompasses that Mark's referred to today. Andrew is a former chair of Green Cross Limited, a company that he first became involved with 30 years ago, where he gave them some consulting advice. As the founder of Green Cross was a final year veterinary student. It's a fascinating story, and they have really used scaling up. That's on Thursday at 12 noon AEST. To register, please go to www.essbiztools.com.au/webinars. If you need any more information, please send me an email, peter@essbiztools.com.au. Or you have a question to ask Mark, just send it to me I will pass it on to Mark. Although what I'm going to do is go back to Mark now. Mark, do you just want to give us your contact email address if people want to communicate?
Yeah, sure, Pete. To contact me, it's mark.holton, H-O-L-T-O-N, at smithinc, that's S-M-I-T-H-I-N-K.com.
Mark, thank you very much for joining us.
Pleasure, Pete. Enjoyed the chat.
Yes, and hopefully you, the participants in this chat, enjoyed it. If you need more information, please contact us, and good luck. And if you're in the lockdown areas, please stay safe. That includes you, Mark, of course, because I know you're definitely in those lockdowns. And whichever team wins on Sunday evening, let's hope it's a great game of football.
Yes,
I have. As long as it's South, Mark will say.
I have. It's a great game of football, and only South win, Pete.
He's a wee bit biased.
Thanks very much.
Everyone, thank you very much. And for those Penrith supporters, we're not trying to really upset you.
But, yes, I am, Pete. I am.
But I hope it's a great event. And obviously, I'm in Queensland. I'm not in Brisbane, but in Queensland. So Queensland does welcome those two great Sydney clubs to this big event at Suncorp Stadium on Sunday evening. Thank you very much. Have a great day. Goodbye. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Pete. See ya.
Thank you.